Well, we've talked a lot on this program about the problem of bullying in schools. We've covered the deaths of a number of kids who've actually taken their own lives after being relentlessly bullied. You may remember Carl Joseph Walker-Hoover. He's there on the left. He was in the sixth grade. Students taunted him, saying he acted gay. He hanged himself. He was just 11 years old. Jaheim Herrera, also age 11, same kind of taunts. He also hanged himself. So did Ryan Halligan, bullied, taunted by the girls, called a loser. Eric Mohat, bullied again and again until one day he took a gun from his father's dresser drawer and turned it on himself. All too often, as we have seen, parents of kids who've been bullied find that schools don't take the problem seriously enough. Here's what Carl's mother said recently on Capitol Hill.
I did everything that a parent is supposed to do. I chose a good school. I joined the PTO. I went to every parent-teacher conference. I called the school regularly, and I brought the bullying problem to their staff's attention. The school did not act. The teachers did not know how to respond.
Well, right now there's legislation making its way through Congress, the Safe Schools Improvement Act. It defines bullying as conduct placing students in reasonable fear of physical harm. Conduct based on race, color, national origin, disability, religion, sex, or sexual orientation. All standard characteristics for civil rights legislation. But a conservative group focused on the family is objecting to the bill and other efforts to fight bullying, saying that gay activists are using the bullying issue to push their agenda in the schools. Joining us tonight is Candi Cushman of Focus on the Family, Eliza Byard, Executive Director of the Gay, Lesbian, and Straight Educational Network, and Rosalind Wiseman. She works with schools across the country on bullying issues. She's also the author of Queen Bees and Wannabees, Helping Your Daughter Survive Cliques, Gossip, Boyfriends, and the New Realities of Girl World. Appreciate all of you being with us. Candi, let me start with you. You say that gay groups are using anti-bullying efforts to push what you say is a gay agenda, teaching kids about gay marriage and gays and lesbians and homosexuality. My question, I guess, is if there are gay kids in schools being bullied, and even if there are kids who aren't gay but are perceived as that or just being called the F word and harassed, how do you suggest stopping that if you can't mention anything about gays and lesbians?
Well, first, just let me say that we absolutely think every child should be protected from bullying. We know that bullies target children for a myriad of reasons. It could be that they're a little overweight, they wear glasses, maybe they're a special needs child, maybe they do identify as gay or lesbian, and we believe that all of those kids, without exception, should be protected from bullying.
So how do you do that, though, without mentioning gays or lesbians or mentioning, you know, race or any of those other things when you're trying to combat it?
Well, we think that bullying policies, bullying prevention policies, would be most effective if they address the far-reaching nature of this problem, which is so many kids, 30% of American children are dealing with this. So we really feel like the most effective policies and initiatives would be ones that protect any child against bullying for any reason.
But what does that mean? I mean, how do you do that?
The correct focus would be preventing the wrong actions of the bully, not focusing on the characteristics of the victims, because it doesn't matter why the victim was targeted. What matters is that their harming them was wrong for any reason.
Okay, let me, Eliza, your group GLSEN has been accused by Focus on the Family of spreading what they call a gay agenda in schools. Why do you need to talk about or mention gays and lesbians in anti-bullying efforts?
Well, Candi and I absolutely agree that all students need to be protected. The fact is, and the data bears out, if you don't mention this specific problem, teachers don't act and students don't have a better experience. Our bill would cover all students, but indicates specifically that you must also include attention to these characteristics. And when you do, our data shows rates of harassment and victimization of LGBT, lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender students goes down. If you don't mention that, there's no effect.
Candi, are you opposed to mentioning, you know, issues of race, or opposed to mentioning issues of, I don't know, disability or a myriad of other reasons kids could be taunted that you mentioned? I mean, are you okay with mentioning those things in stopping
trying to address anti-bullying? Well, what we're in favor of are objective bullying policies that prevent bullying for any reason against any child. You know, I would be concerned if you start listing out too many categories. You're going to leave some kids off the list. What about overweight? What about kids that wear glasses?
But can a teacher talk about that to a classroom? Can a teacher say, well, you know, some people are taunted because of race, and let's talk about that, or let's talk about being overweight and let's talk about that. Is that okay for you?
Well, what we're responding to through our website, truetolerance.org, which I think spurred some of this discussion, is that we're hearing from parents that are having homosexuality lessons presented to their kindergartners in the name of anti-bullying. And we just don't feel like that's necessary and even the most effective way to prevent bullying.
Let me bring in Rosalind on that just to address that point. Actually, Rosalind, let me come to you in a second. Eliza, is that true? Are you guys addressing it?
Listen, I think the first thing I want to say is that Focus on the Family has chosen, and Candi, you have chosen, to attack the Safe Schools Improvement Act. What we find is that when school-level policies actually mention sexual orientation and gender identity, rates of bullying and harassment go down. And this is for all students. In 2005, students of all sexual orientations, races, religions told us when their school had this kind of policy in place, those students were less likely to say that bullying was a serious problem in their school.
Rosalind, you work with schools all the time. You travel around the country. What do you actually see? I mean, you see an agenda being spread? And can you address bullying? I mean, basically, Focus on the Family is saying focus on the bully. Is that an effective program?
Well, two things. One is that as a counselor who is actually going to be administrating this program, you have so many things to do that usually what happens is, even with all these mandates, the best you're going to get is a 45-minute presentation with like 500 kids, because a lot of our programs in schools are at big schools, 3,000 kids, 2,500 kids. So the logistics of this make this pretty much impossible to be able to do. That's the first thing. The second thing is, this is not just about the gay kids in school, it's about everybody, because bullying does not exist without homophobia. Kids are proving, they have to prove that they belong to be men. They have to prove that, you know, you're in seventh grade and you say something, you're speaking out about something being cruel, then someone is going to say to you, don't be gay. And that stops you from being able to say what you really want to say, which is don't do it. And so that's literally teaching you to be paralyzed and say, to be silent in the face of cruelty. And so it's not just about the gay kids being safe, which I believe 100% they have the right to be. It is also about everybody in the school feeling that they have the right to speak out. And if we don't name this behavior, then we are going to lose it. And it's going to go back to bullying in the playground is the problem. And we're going to lose all of the improvements that we've made.
Candi, the idea of naming that behavior, you're opposed to, yes?
Well, I would be in favor of a teacher directly confronting a child bullying another child that's identified as gay. I think that should be stopped. But our viewpoint comes from the belief that all human beings, all students are created in God's image, and they deserve to be protected because they are a human being uniquely created by God with innate dignity and worth, and not because of the political subgroup they identify with or how they identify sexually. That's how we think these bullying policies should be based. Widespread neutral protection.
Okay, Anderson, can I say, but in all respect, that does not in any way reflect the reality of what schools are like. So we can have policies that are about ideal reality, or we can have policies that are about concrete reality and reflect what children are experiencing. And that's when we become relevant to young people.
So why doesn't it work, Rosalind, though, to just focus on the bully? I mean, basically, you know, if you read the Focus on the Family,
you have to do both.
What they are saying is, you know, they have basically a three-page thing saying, you know, bullying is bad. You should, you know, punish the bullies, not tolerate it. You know, not tolerate people, you know, attacking anybody who's come forward to speak. What's wrong with just that?
Because when you do that, it becomes a gray area, and it becomes a he said, she said, or he said, he said thing, and it becomes a way of, it's on the onus is on the victim to be able to prove without a shadow of a doubt that what has happened to him or what has happened to her is so difficult that it's impossible for them to be able to go to school, right? That's what we're doing. That's what we're talking about. Well, if you take out that language of naming the behavior, then it becomes so amorphous that there's nothing to talk about. There's no place to talk. There's no place for that kid to define what is happening to them. And they also feel like they're so ashamed that this is, you know, they can't talk about it. These words are not allowed to be talked about. And so then they lose the whole process and the ability to have the conversation.
Well,
they become silent.
But, you know, there's certainly a lot of parents who, you know, don't believe that being gay or being lesbian is okay and don't want their kids, especially very young kids, exposed to that. What do you think that this should be mandatory for everybody?
The Safe Schools Improvement Act is about behavior, not beliefs. And as a common ground issue, apart from any other kind of diversity curriculum or the importance of respect in a diverse society, just looking at the Safe Schools Improvement Act and the problem of bullying, when you name the problem, people act. Teachers in schools that have these policies are more likely to stop this, and kids are less likely to be harassed and victimized. And essentially also, as Rosalind is referring to, bullying is a dynamic in a classroom. Bullies need our help, victims need our help, and bystanders need our help. They need adults to act, to take care of the culture of that classroom, and build a culture of respect.
Candi, very briefly, I want to give you the final thought.
Well, what we're concerned about are the parents that we're getting phone calls from that don't want controversial sexual topics introduced to their kids without their permission, especially at the kindergarten level. And that's why we wanted to say that this issue doesn't need to be politicized. We don't need to bring adult political agendas into it. We want all kids to be protected from bullying for any reason, regardless of how they identify.
Candi Cushman, I appreciate you being on. Eliza Byard as well.
Thank you.
And Rosalind Wiseman, thanks very much.